N is for notable and willing to share. U is for understanding, she really cares. R is for reliable, right from the start. S is for sincere, with a loving heart. E is for energetic, so much to behold. Nurse, a special one is she, more precious than gold. A very happy International Nurses Day to all of us. Good morning, respected Principal Ma'am, honorable faculty members, and my dear students. A very happy International Nurses Day to all of you. I take this privilege to welcome you all to this beautiful morning celebrating International Nurses Day, the day that marks the birth anniversary of Florence Nightingale, the lady with the lamp, the founder of modern nursing, who still stands an example of importance of nursing profession. Today, in this hard time when the world is suffering from coronavirus pandemic, this day holds a remarkable significance to honor the tireless efforts of the nurses who are paying a lot of hard work, longer shifts filled with physical, psychological, and emotional stress. We acknowledge our inevitable contribution to the well-being of the nation by celebrating today. Let us commence the ceremony with the graceful lamp lighting video made by our post-basic nursing students.
दीप ज्योति परम ज्योति दीप ज्योति जनाधना दीप हस्तु मे पापम दीप ज्योति नमस्तुते
लाइट सिंबलाइजेस ब्राइटनेस एंड प्रोस्पेरिटी इट रिमूव्स द फोर्सेस ऑफ डार्कनेस एंड गिव अस पॉजिटिविटी इन स्पिरिचुअल वर्ल्ड लाइट मीन्स लाइफ सो We can also think of life as giving us new direction in life. With this noble thought, let us start this occasion by lighting the lamp in front of Goddess Saraswati.
For this divine experience, and your creativity is really appreciable. Florence Nightingale's vision completely changed society's approach towards nursing. With her selfless contributions and service to mankind, she raised the stature of nursing from an unskilled profession to a medical profession. I would like to repeat Florence Nightingale's lines of wisdom. I attribute my success to this. I never gave or took an excuse. I hope her story and her inspirational words will give all of us a needed boost so that we may confidently step up to the challenges or goals that we face. As we appreciate nurses, the day also presents an opportunity for drawing attention to thematic clause for the upliftment of nursing profession. The theme for this year, 2020, which is regarded as the International Year of the Nurses and the Midwife by International Council of Nurses, the theme for this year is Nurses, a voice to lead, nursing, the word to health. This theme focuses the true value of nurses to the people of the world. I request our respected principal, Dr. Mrs. Jyoti Sareen Ma'am, to put light on the fact that is Florence Nightingale relevant today? Ma'am, over to you. Okay.
Thank you so much, Parvinda. It is indeed an honor, pride, and pleasure to extend greetings and wishes on International Nurses Day on behalf of Nursing Fraternity of Maharishi Markandeshwar deemed to be university. The question posed is Florence Nightingale still relevant today? Yes. 200 years later, the foundation for nursing profession, which were laid by Florence Nightingale, still holds true. Reflection on how nursing practice has evolved over years can be used as compass to guide us marching forward. All of us know about Florence Nightingale's understanding of physical and psychological environment, concept of hygiene, health and healing, comfort and nourishment. And all these concepts still holds true for new generation Nightingales, for providing comprehensive care and having holistic approach towards patient care. She was a public administrator. She empowered women. Therefore, nursing is still a women-dominated profession. Her statistical and analytical skills, visual and graphical representation influenced hospital management to a great extent. Today, although world is facing global health inequalities, shortage of frontline warriors, threat of antimicrobial resistance, resurgence of infectious diseases, emergence of new threats such as HIV, Ebola, SARS, MERS, and recently the globe is facing pandemic of COVID-19. Florence Nightingale's teaching on hygiene remains exemplary as we battle with sepsis, hospital acquired infections, and COVID-19. It is expected that antimicrobial resistance will be the leading cause of mortality by 2050. And all we as nurses understand that hand washing and hygiene will be the most potent defense against transmission of diseases. So, what we are expected? We as nurses have taken the leadership and should continue to take leadership for antibiotic stewardship, empower patients and their families on issues pertaining to health and wellness, make healthcare information accessible and understandable to each and every one. That is, it should be jargon-free information and it should dispel myths and misconceptions. Nurturing is a positive relationship and it is a core of nursing. Emotional intelligence is key to this relationship and is at the heart of care. The art and science of nursing is to assess, identify, prioritize, and implement a rational course of action and evaluate in terms of patient's outcome. Various research and scientific evidences have shown that delivery of primary healthcare services by nurses, nursing-led care clinics has shown positive outcomes in terms of promoting adherence to treatment or compliance is better, helping the patients and their providers to cope up with the illness and march towards health and well-being. It improves patient satisfaction and reduces rehospitalization. All these evidences and the positive outcomes have enforced and given a thought to policymakers and regulatory bodies, which has resulted in evolving and enforcing concept of nurse practitioners and mid-level providers, as even policymakers have appreciated that sustainable development goals cannot be achieved without significant contribution of nursing professionals. So it is imperative that the concept of hygiene, concept of health and well-being, the statistical analysis and visual graphics which were shown by Florence Nightingale still holds true. I would like that we need to have more nurses who are digital designers, because in the given time of COVID-19, which has taught us many lessons, that it is not in person only, it is by distancing, by staying away, also we can contribute significantly to our profession. So wish you all a very happy International Nurses Day once again. Now I request Dr. Kirandeep Kaur to throw light on the challenges to nursing the world to health. Over to Dr. Kirandeep.
Yes, ma'am. Fundamentally, while health is considered a national asset, there are many different health priorities across different regions. Let's look at some of the challenges that must be addressed as we nurses, the world to health, and the ways in which health systems must change and adapt to meet these challenges. Globally, we are experiencing worrying numbers of all mental illnesses, which are evident by number of statistical studies, and the challenge is wounded in the heart, mind, and body. Mental ill health and mental distress are vastly underreported, and physical mental medical conditions increase the risk of mental illnesses. Continuously, WHO reminds us that there is no health without mental health. All nurses need to be more aware and capable to address the mental health needs of the people. Mental health education in all nursing and midwifery education programs needs to be strengthened. Mental health nurses need to have an equal place on all decision-making bodies and to be enabled to contribute their unique knowledge, skills, and insights to improve the mental health and well-being of all. Another challenge is that health systems should be capable of meeting the needs of individuals and communities. A health system is meant to restore health and alleviate suffering. A high-performing health system has a holistic understanding of people's needs. Maintaining high-quality care requires a focus on human resources for health, with particular emphasis on nursing, as the largest provider of frontline health services in the world. Next challenge is that too many people in our world experience health inequities because of divided communities and unequal world. These people struggle to fulfill the most basic needs such as healthcare, education, clean water, and sanitation. The nursing profession is rooted in a fundamental concern for the social, emotional, and physical needs of the disadvantaged. Nurses, as the largest component of the healthcare workforce throughout the world, can help health systems become more sustainable. They can raise awareness of the health implications of climate change and advocate for policy changes. In future, the nursing profession should be able to address the social determinants of health to create a more just and equitable world. Thank you, and wishing you all a happy International Day. For next, over to Professor Kanika.
Thank you, Kiran ma'am, and good morning to all of you. First of all, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Jyoti Sareen ma'am, Director Principal MM College of Nursing, for providing us all with this opportunity to have the deliberation on the occasion of International Nurses Day. So I'll also be highlighting few of the challenges that the nurses have to face in the current scenario for giving care to the patients. And first of all, the challenge comes in the terms of hope at the end of life, and what is the role of nurses towards caring for the patients who are having the terminal illness. So we know that dying is a very universal process. And it also is a very human, very universal human experience. But how different individuals or the human beings, they experience dying has been addressed by a number of factors. And that is why the role of nurses becomes of paramount importance in this regard. And we all know that hope can mean different, hope can have actually different meanings for different people. For some people, hope means to have the positive relationships. For other people, hope means to have a good quality of life. And for some people, hope means to have the ability to set and achieve the realistic goals. And for the people who are experiencing the terminal illness, hope for them is considered as prolonging their life, which otherwise is not actually possible. So here is the role of nurses. And this is the challenge particularly faced by the nurses with the people who are into the dying process, to provide comfort to these patients and to provide the universal access or the coverage of healthcare to these patients so that they can have a smooth transition towards the end of their life. And the major challenge which the statistics has shown in regard to this is that every year around 40 million people are in need of palliative care. And out of these 40%, 78% of the people, they live in low and the middle income countries. And the irony is that only 14% of these 40 million people are able to have the access to the quality care. So the nurses have to bear with this challenge and have to adapt to this situation or the scenario, and they have to provide the quality care to the patients or the palliative care so that they can have a smooth transition. Secondly, I would like to highlight the second challenge, that is, are we doing the right things to meet the health needs of the people we are serving? And in this regard, Dr. Tedros, the Director General of WHO, has stated that every country's journey towards a universal health coverage is a unique journey. But in all the countries, the main key or the important key is the primary care, that is delivering the care to the people which they actually require and not the care which the health professionals think that the people would be requiring. So keeping this in focus, the care has to be given to the patients. And there comes the five rights based upon the statement given by Dr. Tedros, that are we giving the right care to the patient? Are there the right providers for giving that right care? Whether that right care is given at the right time and right place and at the right cost. So that means the affordability, the access, whether the accessible care is given to the patient, whether the care which we are giving to the patients is safe. I was discussing that is the cost of healthcare and the pursuit of value of that cost in the healthcare. And what I had discussed, I would just summarize that according to a report given by WHO, that total health spending out of the percentage of GDP is 6% in low income, 7% in the middle income, and 10% in the high income countries. And this also affects the amount or the percentage of money that the people are able to pay out of their pockets for the health facilities. And for the mostly, if we see in the low and middle income countries, the challenge is utilizing the current workforce in the absence of much amount or the absence of or the low GDP percentage that is to be given for the healthcare facilities. And the main cost for the healthcare facilities is the cost of labor or for the cost of health workers. So the organizations, they always try to have the non-professional help or the non-professional workers into the healthcare organization, which would ultimately affect the patient care and would have the long the recovery time will also prolong, and the poor satisfaction among the patients will also be there. So the researches have shown that if there are advanced practitioner nurses working in the clinical area and they are giving care to the patients and they are assessing the patient and they are able to make adequate referral to the specialist, so the people have shown a very good satisfaction with that care, and the care is also termed as equivalent to the care that is provided by the physicians. So in the absence of physicians, the advanced practitioner nurses, they have an important role to play. So to sum up all these things, there is an effort required to educate and to update the knowledge of nurses and to make the nurses as an independent practitioner so that they can work in the clinical environment and they could provide the quality care to the patients. So at the last, I would just like to finish up with a famous quotation given by Maya Angelou. And what she said was, a bird doesn't sing because it has an answer. It sings because it has a song. So for all the nurses out there, I would just like to say that be a bird that sings and have a voice that leads. Thank you and wishing all of you a very happy Nurses Day. And next, I would like to request Dr. Poonam Chiron ma'am to throw some light on harnessing the potential of nursing in the world. Over to Poonam Chiron ma'am.
Thank you, Kanika, and good morning all. Sorry, my network connection is very unstable right now, so I cannot put on the video here. So sorry for that, but then taking ahead the thing which where the Kanika has left, sharing the different challenges which are faced by the nurses while attaining the goal of health for all. In this particular session, or the third part of the today's presentation, we will be focusing more on harnessing the potential of nurses by leading the people or the world to health. Now, most of the time it happens that the nursing is one of the most trusted profession around the world and people do trust. But then most of the work of this profession goes unexplored and unpublicized. Whereas nurses still continue to be the forefront of the patient care delivery system. So keeping the 5 hours of the challenges which were explained by Professor Kanika, we have to see that how best we can harness the potential of nurses and build the workforce not only for today but for tomorrow as well in this changing times. So we will discuss in this session the importance of good care environment for the nurses, transform the nursing education to improve the practice and promote the lifelong learning among the nurses, and then how to retain those skillful nurses through the recognition and rewards. And at the end, Mr. Yogesh Kumar sir also will be discussing the utilization of the technology to address the nursing shortage and to ensure the nursing workforce sustainability. Now, moving ahead in the harnessing the potential, all of the time around the world, the Global Health Organization statistical data has shown that out of total workforce at the higher level, at the policy making level, it's only 31% women are there in the ministers of health, which shows that even though they have potential, even though they have caliber, but because of the glass ceiling, which is there because of the gendered nature of the society and the dual workforce or the dual work and family roles of the women and the low availability of the child care, nurses being women, majority of the women being there in the nursing profession, they face these challenges. And Nursing Now campaign has shown that the women nurses face glass ceiling into the profession where the male nurses have the glass elevator over there. So keeping these challenges in mind, we have to see that yes, how well we can harness the potential of that this workforce, either male or female, whomsoever are comprising it, and how to make this as a better workplace for them so that they can provide the optimum care and can lead the world to the health. Now, without forgetting the critical contribution of nursing to the health, we have to always remember, and it is being recognized by different organizations worldwide, that nurses makes the health, nurses needs to imperative in making the health and social policies. And there is a need to stress more leadership education and opportunities for the nurses. Now, year 2020 as being the year of nurse and midwife, WHO has released the first state of world's nursing report. That's a complete statistical data around the world that how many nurses are available and which all conditions they are working. And this has led different governments to think more deeply about the nursing and to tackle the projected global shortfall of 9 million nurses by 2030. It's been projected that the world will be having the shortage of 9 million nurses by 2030. So we can think of that how we are going to meet this particular challenge of the man shortage into the nursing field when we are looking up so many of the non-communicable diseases and the age-related problems where the nursing interventions are going to be very, very potentially beneficial for the people, those who are dealing with these non-communicable disease, mental health issues, or age-related issues. So it at the time when we are facing the global nursing shortage, this particular time has created a greater imbalance between the nursing workforce supply and demand. So to deal with that supply and demand is one thing for which we need to harness the potential of nurses, those who are working full-time into the nursing profession. apart from that, we have to really empower our nurses to take hold of power. Traditionally, nurses have always shied away with the word power. They feel more competent to participate into the active patient care, but they have always shied away from participating into the policy making and leadership in the health beyond the professional nursing practices. So the Global Nursing Leadership Institute by International Council of Nurses and Nursing Now campaign is leading the way for making the nurses aware, acknowledge and appreciate and embrace the power to make those changes into the health policy which are going to be beneficial for the patients or the population to whom they are going to care in the upcoming times. Most of the time it happens that nursing education, continuous nursing education, basically it just focuses on the personal and interpersonal development of nurses, professional development of nurses. But most of the time, the organization and political understanding of the scenario, policy understanding, which are there into the government at the international level, nurses are not well aware of that and they are not prepared for that. So these are the lack of these opportunities basically explain the nurses' lack of readiness to step forward to lead in the health. So we have to take care and we have to make sure that the personal and interpersonal development should also make sure that the organizational and political understanding is also fostered among the nurses, and future leaders are prepared within the current nurses, either they are in-service nurses or the pre-service nurses, so that they can lead the world towards the health. Next step in harnessing the potential of the nurses is towards the partnership and collaboration. Now, though nurses are frontline health leaders, but they must identify the current and the future opportunities for collaboration and the partnership for leadership. Because if they want to take hold of the front, or they want to be the leaders, then they definitely it cannot be all alone. We have to take the people along with us, and for that, the partnership and the collaboration with other professions is must for that. Because the healthcare providers are not just nurses, we are a team, and then that collaboration, the partnership and the recognition for each other's contribution is must into that. So the interprofessional education and collaboration practice, which is also known as the IPECP, is a key method for improving the global health through the participation and the collaboration among different professions. Three pillars of the universal health, that is access, quality and cost. It requires innovation and the radical rethinking right now. Rethinking in the terms like nurses being the critical and the most dependable manner of the healthcare team, they need their skills to be tuned up and appreciated and improved in terms of the primary care level, that is in terms of prevention, immunization or the home-based care. At the secondary level, in terms of inpatient clinics or surgery, and in the tertiary care where the specialized care or the non-communicable disease particular nursing interventions are required. So nurses have to be prepared to deal with at all these three levels of care, either the primary, secondary and tertiary. And as Professor Kanika has elaborated much in detail, how the research findings have shown that the nurse practitioners, those who are taking the independent lead, has shown that this is a cost-effective care which is equally benefited as per the physicians can be provided by the nurses. Only thing is that we have to prepare nurses to take that lead, not only in terms of the bedside care or into the patient care, rather that lead has to be there in terms of making the policies, changing the global scenario, how the resources are allocated and have a voice to lead so that the funds can be relocated appropriately at the required place. Though we are facing the man shortage and nurse to population ratio is very disturbed or skewed around the world, but then in the upcoming changes or the upcoming times of changes where the new researchers are giving very amazing results around the world, it has shown that the current curriculum with which we are preparing the nurses, that needs a radical rethinking. we need to not just rely upon the ratios or the global ratios or the nurse-patient ratios, because the new technologies, new models of care which are coming, new innovative learning approaches like online learning, all of us are learning these days. All these things need to be incorporated into the curriculum so that the nurses can embrace that technology in the new curriculum and be ready to take the lead into the world for the upcoming times. Now, the call of action basically is that there has to be appreciable innovation into the nursing education, collaboration and partnership and entrepreneurship into the nurses. Nurses are not very comfortable with these words, leadership, entrepreneurship and all those things. So these things need to be fostered and incorporated into the academia and practices. More and more role models have to be there for the pre-service nurses into the clinicals or into the academia, taking lead for the leadership roles, for the entrepreneurship, for the collaboration and partnership, so that they can learn and they can become comfortable with these concepts and can develop a greater synergy between the practice and education while incorporating the principles of interprofessional collaboration. So with this, I just summarize my topic over here, that while for harnessing the potential of future nurses or the current nurses, whomsoever we are having, keeping all these 5 R's of challenges which are thrown by the WHO or the researcher or the personal experiences of the nurses around the world, we need to have safe working environment, sustained qualified skilled nurses, lifelong education for the nurses, and the technology to lead the world to health. And to further elaborate on this, I request Professor Uma ma'am to take on the stage. Over to you, Uma.
Environment and further to good work environment. As Dr. Poonam shared regarding how the world, how the health, as Dr. Poonam shared regarding how world to health through good leaders can be led, I would like to share a few details how safe care environment can lead to good work environment. Secondly, how preparing nurses for practice through education can be lifelong learning. And thirdly, a perennial challenge for safe staffing. So evidence studies and reports say that medical errors are leading cause of death and morbidity globally. Care environments can be hazardous for both patients and nurses who are charged with care and safety of patients. The path-breaking patient safety report states a move away from blaming individual clinicians for their mistakes. Instead, defines safety as the responsibility of the hospital to redesign care environments and workplaces to keep patients safe. So international studies clearly state a good work environment is feasible if the healthcare is financed and managed. Improvements in work environments are closely linked with improvement in the outcome. So with this slide, we can see poor work environment can lead to poor patient outcomes and adverse outcomes of nurses. And poor patient outcomes causes mortality. It causes readmissions. The length of stay is increased for the patients. Hospital-acquired infections can come, and false and decubitus ulcers. Whereas the adverse outcomes of nurses, you can see that there are a few listed out, like burnouts, job dissatisfaction, and intent to leave. That is, retention is becoming very difficult for these people when the poor workout environment is there for them to work. A good environment is one which implements evidence-based practice with high degree of reliability. And this has been further studies have been done and evidence have shown that internal expertise from nurses and other health professionals suggested that innovations and improvements in patient care can improve the outcome of the work environment of the patient and cause a good work environment or good care environment. And so the concept of magnet hospital is evolved. So magnet hospitals have proved to be a better place to work for nurses as it has attracted and retained them and also produced better outcomes for the patient. So magnet hospitals follow five main components, that is, the five components are the transformational leadership, that is, senior nurses and other healthcare professionals are responsible to prepare the junior staffs for future. Structural empowerment is the second component. The infrastructure, policies, programs, systems of healthcare in an organization together can work miracles. Then exemplary professional practice. The patient has to be treated in an extraordinary professional nursing practice so that it could set an example. Then a fourth component is new knowledge, that is innovation and improvement. The new methods, procedures, rules and regulations as well as ethical or moral responsibilities contribute to a nursing profession, welfare of patient and goodwill of an organization. And the fifth last component is empirical quality outcomes. That is checking the improvements on regular basis makes an organization outshine and improve standards too. So this is one way that the environment can be made good and the outcome can be very good. So the next thing that I would like to share is education. Preparing nurses for practice through education should be a lifelong learning, and the key for this one is transformation of nursing education. And why we need to do this is due to changes of the epidemiological profiles of population, technological advancement, knowledge proliferation, rapid changes in health systems around the globe, challenges faced in both quality and quantity of nurses. So the strategies that were identified were creation of workforce based on the role requirement, achievements of higher levels of education by all nurses, and ICN stated that reduce the gap by improving the interface between nursing education and the nursing services. So invest at the pre-service, in-service and continuing education levels. Continuing education must include training and education of leadership, advanced clinical practice, enhancement of research skills, application of evidence, informed practice and policy making, and preceptorship and mentoring. Then interpersonal and collaborative practice must emphasize on optimal clinical care and workforce, that is person-centered collaborative practice responding to local needs. The third thing that I would like to tell is about staff, safe staffing, a perennial challenge. The word perennial means that lasts for a long time. So whatever challenge we have, if it brings about a change, it should last for a long time. How can we meet this perennial challenge? By creating adequate number of nurses within the right mix of education, skill and experience to meet the ever-growing demands of complex patient care in all settings. Second, developing the evidence base for safe staffing and implementing the nurse staffing policy of minimum nurse to patient ratio. And this was explained with a model that was conducted in Queensland healthcare setting, and they implemented a policy establishing minimum nurse to patient ratios in 27 public hospitals, and the result revealed positive changes as a result of nurse to patient ratio policy, which included improved time to complete necessary care and time to detect patient changes, better job satisfaction and less burnout, less likely to give hospital a failing safety or infection prevention grade, and more likely to recommend hospital to family and friends. So data analysis also estimated that the legislation resulted in 145 fewer deaths, 255 fewer readmissions and 29,222 fewer hospital days. So with this, I will hand over the topic to be discussed by Professor Yogesh, which he will then further on the same issue. Thank you, sir.
Respected Principal Madam and faculty members and my dear students, I wish you all a happy Nurses Day once again. As we all are aware that the circumstances created by COVID-19, we all are at the far distances, but we could feel the togetherness with the help of the technology. If I talk about the harnessing the potentials of the technology to improve the health outcomes, I would really say that the technology today is being used to the maximum of its potentials to get better outcomes in the healthcare day by day. Technology has changed the way we communicate and the way we learn and the way we teach and the way how do we conduct the researches and the exercises, different exercises we do to overcome the diagnosis and the treatment. It helps in reducing waiting time and prevention of the errors based on the digital databases and the evidence-based practices. And I would like to share my personal experience in this area, which I have created one research which is still in under circulation to get these databases to be compiled. And we will be sharing soon the results of this, what's the status of technology amongst the different educational professionals compared with the nursing professionals. Then, other than that, I would like also to share about the view which was placed by Dr. Poonam Sharon. She was saying about expressing about the research administration and all these aspects in the area where the nurses are too potent to utilize their capabilities. I will say the new concept which has arisen now with that, the digital entrepreneurship about which she was talking. So nowadays, lot many platforms are being conducted by the nurses and nurse educators. And happy to say that I'm one of the person who is working together with these platforms continuously. But along with that, I would also express that I'm happy to say that the nurses today are empowered with the potentials of the technology in the field of the healthcare, also in the field of education. And the nurses today are recognized globally for boundless potentials and the capabilities to stand first and front. And we are rewarded by the every person of the world by well wishes and their thankfulness. In continuation to this, I would like to add up that the nurses have more and more opportunities for professional development. We have opportunities for better work and life balance along with better pay. Then there are opportunities for higher education and recognition. And this scenario is definitely going to take this profession at its height with its capacity, limitless boundaries, and the extensive roles of the nurses in improving the healthcare outcomes. But looking at demand and the shortage of the nurses, we need to create a strong workforce of the nurses. And I will not speak much, but would like to add up with a say that is, Vayam Rashtre Jagriyam Paricharya, means we are the workforce to overcome the suffering of the people. So here, I would again say that we need to create a strong workforce to bring down this shortage of the nurses. With this, I again wish you all a happy Nurses Day. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to all our nursing leaders for empowering us and making this ceremony a great success. Yes, I am proud to be a nurse because nothing is more satisfying than seeing someone come through a poor prognosis, overcome a storm that they had been weathering, or just lending an ear or shoulder for them to vent or lean on. Presenting to you a video by our proud student nurses.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we all are present here to celebrate a Nurses Day. Yes, I am a nurse and I am proud of it. We do not brag too much, but this is surely true. We have lots of knowledge and lots of skill to help you when you are injured, to help you when you are ill, to help you when you are sick. We work hard to do it well, to bring you back to your health, so you get back what to do, so you get back to being you. This is what we love to do. Yes, I am a nurse and I am proud of it.
The best and beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt. Thank you is one such a prayer among them. With these words, I would once again like to convey my sincere thanks to all the nurses for their endless contribution in healing of those in need. Thank you all. Wish you a very happy International Nurses Day.